الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. There is nothing better in this world than being able to comprehend the speech of Allah, to understand what Allah wants from you. And a lot of Muslims mistakenly take the Quran as a mystic book, meaning if you recite say Yasin 10 times, this is going to happen to you. If you say Qul huwa Allahu Ahad 500 times, this is going to happen to you. We read these things, don't we? No, the Quran is a book of guidance. It's like a map, right? It should take you to the right way. And the only way for you to be guided is to reflect upon it and try to understand it. And that is the main objective of the Quran, of the revelation. أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ. Why don't they reflect upon the Quran? Huh? There is nothing better. And the understanding of the book will be granted to you, but you have to show it. It's something that Allah gives to you. But you have to show it. You have to show it in exhausting the effort. It's not going to come to you while you're busy with this world. You have to designate some of your time, whether in a form of a class or whether in a form of reading a particular book of tafsir, so you're able to understand the Quran. The theme of this class is we want to go through every surah of the Quran in one lecture. That's what we're going to try to do. We've done this with Surah Al-Baqarah. If you want to go back, the higher aim of Surah Al-Baqarah is available online. You can watch it. But what did we conclude, Samir, with Surah Al-Baqarah? What is the higher aim of Surah Al-Baqarah? What was Surah Al-Baqarah is all about? Okay. We are the last ummah sent to mankind. We believe that there is no messenger after us, right? So there is no prophet after us. Our book is the last book. This is the last guidance which will come down from Allah to humanity. We are the last nation presented to mankind. So we were given the leadership. الاستخلاف الأرض. That is why Surah Al-Baqarah was revealed in Medina. Right? Medina meaning after 13 years. And in some narration, 2 more years. You add 2 more years, 15 years of the Prophet rule of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And by the way, there is a saying out there that the last verse of the Quran was revealed in Surah Al-Baqarah. وَاتَّقُوا يَوْمًا تُرْجَعُونَ فِيهِ إِلَى اللَّهِ ثُمَّ تُوَفَّى كُلُّ نَفْسٍ مَّا كَسَبَتْ وَهُمْ لَا يُظْلَمُونَ. The scholars of tafsir, they said, only 22 days. 22 days. Now why, or what is the wisdom Allah placed at the very beginning of the Mus'haf? Al-Fatiha, then Al-Baqarah. Because this chapter prepares us to be leaders. To be leaders of earth. Listen, whether you believe this or not, that's the reality. And we were leaders for a period of time, you agree? We're leaders, weren't you? Weren't we? We were. But what happened when we abandoned the manhaj, the curriculum? Khalas, we're done. We're down. So now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Baqarah granted us the manhaj, the curriculum, the manuscript, the blueprint. You know when you go and buy a car, what they give to you with the car? What? Manual. How to what? How to maintain this car. Now for you to be leaders, that's what you have to follow. What you have to follow. Right? And if you follow this, I will help you to lead the earth. If you stick to this guidance, I will help you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Baqarah given us very interesting, and I'm going to review because I see some faces, very interesting models. Experimental model. I know I have a lot of typos, but I'm relying on you guys being born here. You know what English is, right? But that word is experimental. Two, failing. Well, let's be respectful here. Unsuccessful model. Three, successful model. What was the experimental, Samir?
Adam.
Allah places Adam in a garden and tells him, I'm going to take care of you. I'm going to give you whatever you want. But with one condition, don't eat from that tree. And by the way, there will be an enemy out there who's going to try to get you to do it. Why I'm saying it's experimental? Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put Adam to a test, and he knew that Adam would fail the test, and he permitted this to happen. And I use the hadith that Adam and Musa met the night of al-Mi'raj. There is a hadith, authentic hadith. You know, the Prophet led all the messengers in Salah al-Masjid al-Aqsa the night of what? Ascension. So imagine Musa saw Adam, his grandfather. So he approached him. You are Adam. Hey, good to see you. You're the one who got us out of the garden. You're the one who got us in trouble, basically. That's what he said to him. But look at the wisdom of the grandfather now. You are Musa. Allah wrote the Torah to you with his own hands. Didn't you read in the Torah that this was written upon me? So it's experimental. Basically, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted the offspring of Adam to see what the whole thing played here, played out. Listen, you have an enemy out there who's going to whisper to you. He's going to try to get you in trouble. And he's going to try to trick you. You see, when Adam said to, when Iblis said to Adam, eat from the tree, he didn't say to him, eat from the tree. No, he said, I just want to show it to you. I just want to show it to you. And actually, Satan said, Wallahi, waqasamahuma. He said, Wallahi. That's why Adam believed him, but because Adam did not expect someone to use the name of Allah in vain. For him, this was what? Oh, this guy is telling the truth. He said, Wallahi, waqasamahuma inni lakuma lamina nasihin. I'm telling you the right thing. Come and eat from the tree. That is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells offspring of Adam, don't follow the shaitan. Don't follow his foot. He's going to get you in trouble. So, Ishahid also in that story, in that experiment, Allah tells us what to do when we get in trouble. What did Adam do? Because we're not perfect, right? What did Adam do right away? I'm sorry, I made a mistake. And a lot of us do this. That's all what you have to do is repent. Come back to Allah. And Allah will accept you like he accepted Adam again, as long as you're alive. But this was the experimental one. In that story also, Allah told us in Surah Al-Baqarah in particular, the significance of knowledge. Not the knowledge of the revelation, but the dunya knowledge. If you want to be leaders of humanity, you must excel in that field as well. وَعَلَّمَ آدَمَ الْأَسْمَاءَ كُلَّهَا. He taught Adam the names of the things. Tells you it's important. If you want to take the lead, you can't be backward in an iPhone and IT. You have to be what? You have to be both. You have to develop both to be leaders. You can't just offer the world spiritual nourishment and neglect their physical, their livelihood, their, you know, you can't be a leader. A leader offers what? Both to humanity. The unsuccessful model is Bani Israel. That is why Surah Al-Baqarah talks about Bani Israel right and left. They did this, they did that, they did this, they did that, they did this, they did that. In a way, don't be like them. Don't be like them. And I told you, there are almost 10 stories in Surah Al-Baqarah. Stories out of this world. Out of this world. Why did Allah choose the story of the cow to name this chapter after? Because it shows you how Bani Israel dealt with the command of Allah. Some of you may not be aware of the story that somebody killed the guy. Can you move here, please? Are you in high school? You go to high school? Elementary still? Okay, so we understand. Good to see you. All right. So, some guy killed the guy. Who killed him? We don't know. So they start accusing one another. So they said, why are we arguing when we have the Messenger of Allah amongst us? Someone who speaks to Allah. Let's go to Musa and he's going to guide us in what to do. So they went to Musa, listen, we found a murder, someone who is murdered, and for us is a mystery. Can you help us solve that mystery? So Prophet Musa made dua, and then he came back to him and he said, Allah is asking you to slaughter a cow. Quite frankly, there is no relevance. If you think about it, what is the relationship between solving a mystery, a crime, and a cow? What is? But who's commanding you? Who? Huh? Who? Be a wisdom. That's how we deal with the command. You see, Muslims, you don't have to understand exactly the objective or the essence. As long as the command is authentic from Allah, you gotta believe it. And look, you know this scene happened during the time of the Prophet. Imagine the Arabs wake up one day and the Prophet is telling them, by the way, last night I went to Jerusalem and I came back. You know, for them at the time, this was what? Come on. We've been trying to accommodate you here, but this is what? It's like exactly now I tell you last night, Samira, by the way, I went to the moon. You know, it's exactly like that. By the way, some of you may not know that some Muslims left Islam because of this. Some Muslims. Okay, that's too much. No. So they went to Abu Bakr. They targeted Abu Bakr. You know what Abu Bakr asked them? Did he say that? Then it's true. إِنْ كَانَ قَالَ فَقَدْ صَدَقْ. If he said it, then he spoke the truth. خلاص. That's how a Muslim. For you, by the way, I should have mentioned this. You know, for you to deal with the curriculum or the manuscript to be successful and to avoid being unsuccessful, look, the speech of Allah. Memorize this line. The speech of Allah. Whether is information, we call it akhbar in Arabic. Or commands. Amr. Akhbar. Awamir. That's the speech of Allah. The Quran or the Sunnah. Whether it is information. What do you mean information? Information about the unseen. Who is Allah? Who are the angels? Things you do not see, Allah told you about them. Akhbar. Information. All commands, do this, do not do that. Do this, do not do that. The information necessitate, here you go, tasdiq. Tasdiq. You must believe it. Like Abu Bakr said, did he say it? I believe. Even though it doesn't work. There is an angel right sitting right here, writing my good deeds. I believe it. There is an angel sitting right here. Do you see the angel? Do you see it? But I believe there is an angel right here because I was told. Tasdiq. What is tasdiq? What is the English word for tasdiq? I looked and I said attestation, ratification, I don't know. Huh? Tasdiq. That you believe it without any shadow of doubt. You don't question it. Tasdiq. And you know, Bani Israel, the unsuccessful model, you know, they said to Musa, we're not going to execute your commands unless we see Allah. We want to see Allah. وَقَالُوا لَن نُؤْمِنَ لَكَ حَتَّى. Now, you're supposed to believe without what? Without seeing it. Why tawbah, repenting, will not be accepted when we die? Why? What is the wisdom when we're going through the agonies of death? Why? Because you already seen the angels. The angels are sitting out there. They are there to take your soul. It's too late. You're supposed to believe before what? So that requires what? The information necessitate tasdiq. Which word is more comfortable? Attestation? Ratification? Attestation. What about the commands? The commands, the awamir, necessitate what? Compliance with submission. You memorize these lines, gonna help. What's compliance? Do this. What should you say to me? Okay. Comply, not okay. What is the term in Arabic? Okay could mean okay, you know. What is the term in Arabic? What believers say? Sami'na, sami'na, wa ata'na. We hear and we obey. Command from Allah. You see, when Musa said to Bani Israel, slaughter a cow, they should have said what? Okay. Here's a cow right, oh, I'm sorry. Here's a cow right here. Done. Sami'na wa ata'na. Done. It's over. But they came back and they said what? What cow? Which color? Oh, we're still confused. Can you help us out? It's like, is the hijab in the Quran? Huh? Don't you hear that? The hijab in the Quran? Yes, in the Quran. But if I prove to you it's in the Quran, will you wear it? I assure you, the one who is asking that question, she's not going to wear it, even if I show her the evidence in the Quran. Bani Israel were not successful here. They feel this completely. In the area of al-akhbar, you're supposed to believe in the books, right? The books from Allah, they shouldn't be changed. What did they do to the books? What? They altered them. Instead of conveying them, they concealed them. They are supposed to believe in the angels. Guess what? One day they asked the Prophet ﷺ certain questions. And they said to him, if you answer these questions, we're going to become Muslims. The hadith is authentic. So the Prophet answered the questions to them. Then they said, which angel visit you? Jibreel. Oh, this is our enemy. No. If it would have been Mikael, then would have. But Jibreel, لا. Zakr, قل من كان عدوا There's a verse in Al-Baqarah. Say to them, whoever is an enemy to Jibreel, فَإِنَّهُ فَبَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ messed up the whole thing. And the ideal example is the name of the surah Allah chose. Al-Baqarah. Al-Baqarah. What is a successful model? That's the one we should stick to. Ibrahim and his family. If you review the last video, I'm giving the verses numbers. The verse numbers for each model of these. Ibrahim. Imagine Ibrahim was asked to slay his own son, not a cow. What did he do? Not a cow. His own son with his own hand. He was going to do it. He was serious about it. And by the way, some of you may assume that Ibrahim had the feeling that Allah is going to save him. No. Allah commanded me, I'm going to do it. So Surah Al-Baqarah basically gave these models to you, and then in the middle it throws to you all these rulings, ahkam. The longest portion of the surah is about the ahkam. Some of the scholars, 1,000 hukm, 1,000 religious ruling was mentioned in Surah Al-Baqarah. A lot of rulings. That's why one of the later scholars called it, I think it's Sufyan ibn Uyayna, if I'm not mistaken, he called it Fustatul Quran, the stronghold of the Quran, Surah Al-Baqarah. Yeah. And the surah ends. Then comes Al-Imran. That's our surah of today. So this was all what? All was review here. What is the purpose of Al-Imran? The high aim, or the higher aim of Al-Imran, be steadfast on the curriculum. Steadfastness. I showed you the manhaj now. I showed you the curriculum. I showed you the manuscript. Be firm. And by the way, this is one of the most difficult things in Islam, you know. You may, by all of a sudden, for a week or two, you come to the masjid and you're very regular, and then you disappear for 3-4 months. Fisal Imam Muslim, when this companion came to the Prophet, Ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of Allah, قُلِّي فِي الْإِسْلَامِ قَوْلًا لَا أَسْأَلُ عَنْهُ أَحَدًا بَعْدَكَ. Tell me something about Islam that I will need no one else. He said, قُلْ آمَنْتُ بِاللَّهِ ثُمَّ اسْتَقِمْ. Say, I believe in Allah, then be steadfast. That's difficult. Even in the material world, they tell you what? It's easy to reach the top, but it's hard what? Stay there. So, Al-Imran is about this. So let me give you some information, introduction here. Just a little introduction about the surah. And please let me stop if you need further explanation. Surah Al-Imran was revealed in Medina. So it's a Madani surah. It's a Madani surah. It has 200 verses. And it is, subhanallah, the twin of Surah Al-Baqarah in this world and the hereafter. Shaqiqat Al-Baqarah. Al-Imran Al-Baqarah are sisters. In this world and in the Day of Judgment. Wallahi, I mean it. Ask me for the evidence instead of laughing at me. What is the evidence? Isn't Al-Imran comes after Al-Baqarah in the Mus'haf? They started with Alif Lam Mim. They ended with the dua. Al-Imran ended with dua. But what about the hereafter? Qala sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Hadith Abi Umama, Imam Muslim. Iqra'u al-Qur'ana fa'innahu ya'ti shafi'an li ashabihi yawm al-qiyamah. Recite the Qur'an because the Qur'an will come to intercede on your behalf on the Day of Judgment. اقرأوا الزهراويني. Recite the two lights. This is one way to explain it. The two blossoms. The two blossoms. البقرة وآل عمران. Why? فا فإنهما يأتيان يوم القيامة، البقرة وآل عمران will come together in the day of judgment، كأنهما غمامتان like two clouds أو غيايتان two umbrellas أو فرقان من طير صاف or two groups of birds to shade you in the day of judgment in the land of gathering. So they are sisters in the day of judgment or no? They are. They came what? Together. So they must be related. They must be related. So Al-Baqarah presented the curriculum. If you want to be leaders, this is what you have to do. And Al-Imran came. You have to be firm. You can't be wishy-washy. You can't be 50-50. You have to give it full commitment, a conviction to the curriculum, to the manuscript. So Al-Baqarah presented the manhaj. Al-Imran is inviting you to do what? To be steadfast. Steadfast in the face of what? You see, if you read Al-Imran carefully from 1 to 120, from verse 1 to 120, it talks about a delegation called Najran. A Christian delegation. So you have to be steadfast in the face of what? Misconceptions about the religion. You see these two things here. What can mess up your information? Your tasdeeq. What? Having misconceptions. Shubuhat. What can mess up your sami'na wa ta'na, we hear and obey? Whims and desires. Shahawat. Fitnatan. Shubuhat, shahawat. So 120, from 121 to the end of the surah, to 200, it talks about a famous battle in Islam called Uhud. Uhud, the battle of Uhud. You're getting that? So, around those, the surah is talking to you about steadfastness. These guys are not coming to accept Islam. You see, these guys came at the year 9, the year of delegation, when every delegation is just coming. Ya Rasulullah, we like Ashhadu an la ilaha, Ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. This delegation came. Why are you teaching? Who's Jesus? Jesus is the Son of God. What is it? A Trinity. We are inviting you to Christianity. And a whole dialogue in the surah about this. Be steadfast, Muslims, about the information. Uhud, Muslim lost it because of what? Because of what? Did I write whims and desires somewhere? I didn't write it. We said misconceptions. Damages or damage. What? Your tasdeeq. Your attestation. Whims and desires. Nullify your compliance. The Muslims were asked, stay on the top of this mountain. Don't come down until I tell you. Don't imagine. I'll tell you the story of Uhud. But the Prophet said to them, listen, you're going to defend our back. You guys, 50 of you, are going to stay here. You hold these arrows in your hand. They're archers. And you shoot anyone who tries to attack us from the back. Okay, guys, if you fail, they're going to attack us. The Muslims started the battle. Everything is going well. Everyone is following the command of Allah. The Muslims were winning. Those 50 archers saw that the Muslims are chasing the non-Muslims, and the non-Muslims left their stuff behind. They said, guys, the battle is over. Let's come down. Let's collect the sword and the shield that the disbelievers were prepared. They came and attacked the Muslims. The Muslims lost the battle. wanting the dunya. You're getting that. So that's the whole surah. طيب. Are we good? Are we good so far? طيب. Let me ask you this question. Why this surah was called Ala Imran? The main theme of the surah is about who is Jesus. Of course, Christians claim Jesus to be what? The famous claim, the one before he is Lord. Because the one he is Lord, they are still, oh, he's one of three, and they, at least they still tweak it. But the one they are settled on 100%, they say he's what? The son of who? Okay, Ala Imran was, look at the, Jesus is the son of Maryam. Maryam is the daughter of Imran. And that's his lineage. So how do you call him the son of Allah? You know, the Ala Imran is his family. You see, Jesus is the is an offspring of Ala Imran. Ala Imran, if you trace it, who's Ala Imran? Imran was husband of Hannah. Imran and Hannah. Imran and Hannah produced who? Who? Maryam. Maryam produced who? Jesus. So how do you say he's the son of God? He has what? He has a lineage. Yeah, he's not named after a man. Allah named after a mother. Yeah. But it happened before. Adam was created from nothing. Eve was created from Adam. Listen. Allah created from nothing. Created from a male. Created from a female. And created from a male and female. From nothing, who? Adam, I mean from clay in the sense. I mean no, you know, normal process here. Adam, that is why, by the way, the verse come in the مثل, the likeness of Isa in the sight of Allah is like Adam. He created him from what? If there is someone who qualifies to be the son of Allah more, it should be who? Because Adam had no what? But look at him, he had a lineage. What are you talking about? Two, Allah created from a male. Eve is created from who? Adam. A man. And Jesus is created from who? A female. And me and you are what? Male and female. It's just a sign of Allah's what? Power, Allah's strength. So, again, because the surah, Ya Ikhwah, talks about, you know, the lineage of Isa alayhi salam. Another reason, it shows you that there is one segment in the community, if they are steadfast, I'm telling you, the ummah will be in good shape. You know what segment? You know what segment? The ladies, the women. See, Maryam. Can you imagine living in the Middle East? I mean, we still have this culture still in a place called Upper Egypt. Having a child out of wedlock. This is like, you know, right now we live in a country where the girl comes, "Mom, I'm pregnant," and she's not even married. Oh, really? Oh, cool. Imagine there at that time. That's a nightmare. Imagine Maryam and her steadfastness. How she handled this. Being accused of adulteress and how steadfast she was. Huh? It shows you that when the mothers, when the women are steadfast, unfortunately, a lot of our sisters, a lot of our mothers, a lot of our daughters, they abandon the message. And that is affecting us. Because who brings up the children? Who's going to bring up the children? We have no hope. And I always mention, and when I tell the story of Musa, the story of Musa was triggered by who? We reveal to the mother of Musa. Prepare Musa. Not Musa, the mother of Musa. This is why the surah was called that. طيب, let's get to business so we finish on time here. We divided the surah into three main parts. Around these two events, 120 to 121. Number one, the invitation to be steadfast. Come on, look at this man. Look at this. Inna ad-deena 'inda Allahi al-Islam. Shoo. Listen, guys, the religion is Islam. That's the only religion. No other surah in the Quran had the name Islam like Al Imran. وَمَنْ يَبْتَغِ غَيْرَ الْإِسْلَامِ دِينَ فَلَنْ يُقْبَلَ مِنْ Whoever takes another religion other than Islam, it will not be accepted from him. Look at this. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا I'm just showing you what I know, maybe I'm overdoing it, but this is what these verses mean to me. I'm sorry, this is what these verses mean. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ حَقَّ تُقَاتِهِ وَلَا تَمُوتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ Don't you dare die but as Muslims. Be steadfast until when? Until you leave this world. That's fine. Invitation. وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا Be together. ولا تفرقوا. Shall I give you verses numbers? Look at the beginning and the end of the surah. Look at verse 1 and verse 200, the last verse. Look at this. Verse 1 and 200. 1 and 200. So invitation to be steadfast. Verses 1 and 200. شوف 1 ألف لام ميم الله لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم نزل عليك الكتاب بالحق. This Quran has the truth. Look at the end of the surah. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اصبروا. Be patient. وصابروا. ورابطوا. شوف, if you're not patient, make yourselves patient. صابر ورابط. Be firm. الرباط, that you stand like, you know, الرباط المرابط is a person who stands to watch at the borders of the Muslim Ummah to watch the enemies. Anybody is coming, he's always looking. We call them the border what? Border control, something like that. Like the immigration guys. رابط. Don't. Be careful. Don't. Verse 102, the verse that I just quoted. Huh? So again, we're talking about the verses. So we're done with the introduction. Now we're talking about the verses which invite you to be steadfast. That's what we're covering now. Verse 102, what about verse 102? Does it serve that? Does it serve that higher aim? Does it? O ye believe, have taqwa and don't die but what? As Muslims. Verse 103. 103. What about 103? Look at this one. Look at verse 61 and 62. 61 and 62. So when the debate with the delegation of Najran came to a dead end, they didn't accept Islam. They still believe that Jesus is the Son. And the Prophet, of course, didn't compromise. He said, Allah said to the Prophet, what? Call them to an act which was exercised at the time called the Mubahala. Can you read that verse, Samir? 101? No, I'm sorry. 61? Did you get it? Can you read it, the meaning in English? If they still dispute with you regarding this matter, do what? After that, Okay, what we do is, you call your children, I will call my children. You call your women, I will call my women, and we'll go to the top of the mountain, and we do something called mubahala. What is mubahala? I do dua against you, and you do dua against me if I am lying. May Allah curse you if you're lying. May Allah curse you if you're lying. That's actually something that was practiced at the time. By the way, when they went back home to the, when they went back to the masjid where they were staying, and by the way, that delegation never prayed in Masjid al-Nabi, because some people say, oh, that, look, Christians can pray in a masjid. No, never, weak narration. Oh. But they stayed in the masjid, like, you know, any guest. But the shahid is, so they sent somebody to check whether the Prophet is serious about this. Actually, the Prophet went to Ali and Fatima. Okay, Hassan and Hussein, let's go. We have a task. They came back and said, he's preparing his family. He said, they came back, Ya Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, okay, we're going to pay the jizya. We're going to pay the jizya, khalas. But we're not going to do that. They declined. So that's steadfast, being steadfast. Right? Verse 19, we mentioned that. 19. What about 19? Can you look at 19? 83, 84, 85. All of these, be steadfast. طيب. We're done with that. I think we're giving you enough examples here. Then the surah presented the obstacles. So we're done with that now, okay? We're clear here. Did I give you enough examples, guys, from the surah? In both fronts. In the front of the whims and desire, and in the front of the misconceptions. We need to be steadfast. I don't think I've given you enough with the front of the... look at the look at verse 137 to 140. So this is when the Muslims were defeated in Uhud. So they can, how come we're defeated? So Allah is telling them what? Listen, it happened before. Believers were defeated before, but there is a war and there are battles. It doesn't mean that you lost this battle that you lost the war. Don't worry. Allah is treating them. Allah is giving them steadfastness. Just fix the situation. Obey Allah and His Messenger. There is a very profound statement was mentioned regarding Uhud. They say, إِنْ هَزَمَ الْمُسْلِمُونَ فِي أُحُدْ وَانْتَصَرَ الْإِسْلَامِ. The Muslims were defeated in Uhud, but Islam was a winner. Why? The principle of Islam. How would it sound that this archer disobeyed the command of the messenger and they still got victory? How would it sound? That he can do it without what? La. It's a message that is sent to you until the day of judgment. The only way for you to receive help from Allah is what? Is to obey Allah and His Messenger. And that is why there is a mention of Badr. Yani Allah mentioned Badr multiple times. Look at chapter 13 and 123. Look at 13 and 23. 13 and 23. وَلَقَدْ نَصَرَكُمُ اللَّهُ بِبَدْرٍ وَأَنْتُمْ أَذِلَّ. Allah given you victory in Badr when you were 300 facing 1,000. But you qualified to receive Allah's what? Help. But in Uhud, no, you did not. In Uhud, you did not. Because the whims and the desires got you to do what? To compromise this one. You wanted the booty of war. You want the shield. You want these little things. But be careful, ikhwah, Allah has forgiven the Sahaba, so we don't use this in a way to speak bad about the Sahaba. No, not all of them. Actually, the 10 or the 12 and their leader, Abdullah ibn Jubayr, they refused to go down. They were killed. They killed them first. But the majority disobeyed. They said, come on, guys, the war is over. Look at the Muslims and the disbelievers. They left these things. We have to pick up these things. La, you see, you can't do it. No, no. You have. طيب. So basically the invitation to be steadfast in the area of what? تصديق, and in the area of what? سمعنا وطعنا. طيب let's move on inshallah to the next. The obstacles of steadfastness. Read 14, verse 15. Oh. Someone reads it for me. You see, you're going to explain the Quran to me now. Can somebody read verse 14 to me? The biggest obstacle of steadfastness. Can somebody read it to me? Verse 14. Huh? The love of desires. Of what? Number one, women. Ah. Number one. For men, of course. مَا تَرَكْتُ فِتْنَةً. The Prophet ﷺ says, مَا تَرَكْتُ فِتْنَةً أَشَدْ. With all due respect to the sisters, we're talking about, yeah, I have not left a fitna which is stronger in men than women. Two, gold and silver, shield and sword, obstacles of steadfastness, staying on the top of that mountain. But again, this is to us. Obstacles of coming to the masjid to pray. It doesn't have to be a battlefield, by the way. Obstacles of memorizing the Quran. Huh? Obstacles of coming to learn Arabic yesterday. Huh? I missed half of my class. I don't know what happened to them. They make me very happy, but I still give them the class. I don't care. Even if one person sitting here. You know what? I remember this guy at one time, he gave me a lecture, wallahi. What it was, Sheikh, and I remember, I loved the guy. You know, he was giving a lecture and nobody was sitting down in front of him, and he's using the microphone and he's giving the lecture, and he's not back. Alhamdulillah, we're recording it. There are people watching us online a lot, alhamdulillah, but he's sitting down and said, I'm not giving the lecture to nobody. The angels are here and I'm gonna get rewarded. I don't care, you know, maybe the jinn will become Muslims, you know. That's beside the point. So 14, does that serve as an obstacle? Huh? طيب. Two, sins. Look at verse 155, 165, 130. Okay, let me find a place here where we can write the names of these verses. Fadl, fadl.
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Allahu
sins. Look at verse number 130. After a rumor was circulated in the battlefield that the Prophet was killed in this battle, so some of the companions dropped the weapon and they left, went home. Allah is telling them this is because of the sins. So sins can get you in trouble. Look at 130. 130 talks about what? Talks about what? The biggest sin. What is the biggest sin? What this verse talks about? Allah declares war against the Muslims because of that sin. What is the name of that sin? No, we're talking about little sins here, not shirk. What? Usury. Usury. Riba. Yeah, it's called usury, not interest. See, one of the tricks of the shaitan, naming things with more appealing names. Music, oh, it's art. Liquor, spiritual drink. Nudity, fashion. That's how he gets to you. What else? What about, look at 1:3 to 1:05. What is the story between 1:3 and 1:05? 1:3 and 1:05. Obstacles of steadfastness. Differing. What's the story? Before the Prophet ﷺ came to Medina, there were two main tribes, Aus and Khazraj, and they were fighting one another all the time. And guess who was getting them to fight all the time? The guys who manufactured the weapon. Very similar to the story we have now. The guy who make the weapons. So they get them to fight with one another. So when the Prophet came, they became Muslims and they became what? Brothers. So the weapon sale was not doing well. The manufacturers are not, the labor, the people are losing their jobs. We're going to start a war here. We're not making money. So they saw one from Al-Aus, one from Al-Khazraj sitting together and having a good time. So one of them, one of the people who sell the weapons, they sent an agent. And he went and sat in between them. And he started reminding them of the war. Do you remember the battle? He's talking to the Ausi. Your guys defeated them big time. Oh, you guys were... Oh, you got them back. They started fighting. So the Ausi called, Aus, help me. I'm fighting with Khazraj. Khazraj, help me. Another fight broke. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was called to the scene. The one who narrated the hadith that he didn't have time to put his garment on. He actually was dragging it. He came running. I said, what's going on? What happened? What happened? أَبِدَعْوَ الْجَاهِلِيَّ وَنَا بَيْنَ ظَهْرَيْكُمْ. You're going back to Jahiliya while I'm still alive amongst you. دَعُوهَا فَإِنَّهَا مُنْتِنَا. That's the story behind these three verses. وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا وَاذْكُرُوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ إِذْ كُنْتُمْ أَعْدَاءً فَأَلَّفَ بَيْنَ قُلُوبُكُمْ فَأَصْبَحْتُمْ بِنِعْمَتِهِ إِخْوَانًا وَكُنْتُمْ عَلَى شَفَا حُفْرَةٍ مِنَ النَّارِ فَأَنْقَذَكُمْ مِنْهَا. That's an obstacle. Oh, I'm Afghani. No, you're a Muslim, يا أخوي. Oh, I'm Egyptian. No, you're a Muslim. Leave that coloring. Oh, I'm Pakistani. Don't talk to them. Muslim, we're Muslims. What unites us is what? Islam. No. Brotherhood. Look at verse number 44, ya ikhwa. 144, out of this world, a message out of this world. Out of this world. Huh. Can somebody read this to me? One of the obstacles to be steadfast, that you attach yourself to people, not to Allah. And we're talking about the character of who? Oh, Sheikh Karim is no longer here. No problem. The project dies. The project should go on. It's not about people. You see what happened in the Battle of Uhud? When the rumor was circulated that the Prophet was killed, what happened? What happened? They dropped their weapons. They said, okay, Islam is dead. Salam. We're done. وَمَا مُحَمَّدُ إِلَّا رَسُولُ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرُّسُلُ أَفَإِنْ مَاتَ أَوْ قُتِلَ انْقَلَبْتُمْ عَلَىٰ عَقَابِكُمْ. Are you fighting for Muhammad or fighting for Allah and the religion of Allah? Don't cling yourself to people. Don't do that. تعلق بالأشخاص. لا. An obstacle to be steadfast. Because if this person is no longer there, you're going to lose your motivation. You're going to lose your motivation. طيب. The last segment. Elements of steadfastness. Elements of steadfastness in the surah. So these are the verses that covers what? Number three. I know it's a very lousy kind of presentation, but I hope you guys forgive me. And these are the verses that covers what? the invitation, right? Invitation to be steadfast. We have one last point to make. Elements of steadfastness. Where should we write this? You tell me. It seems a different color. What about red here? Let's write them here. I'm going to give you the group of verses. عوامل الثبات. 8, 35, 38, 192, 193, 194. The first element is dua. Ask Allah. You're not going to be steadfast if Allah doesn't help you. Can you read 8 for me? Samir? Number 8. Nasser, you got it?
ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب.
Oh Allah, do not deviate our hearts after you guided us. We want to be steadfast, oh Allah. Umm Salama used to say what the Prophet every day used to make this dua. Ya مقلب القلوب. Oh Allah, you change hearts. Make my heart firm in your religion. ثبت قلبي على دينك. So the first source, the first element is who? Seek Allah to give you steadfastness. And the rest of the verses here is about the dua. So the first element is dua. Second element, ibadah. Be engaged in worshipping Allah. Worshipping Allah. Fulfilling the commands. Look at verses 37 and 39. Maryam, she is in the mihrab all the time making salah. Zakaria, when he wasn't the mihrab. This is the mihrab, the area where the imam stands, right there. You call this the mihrab. You see that place? Not Nabalbit, the mihrab, the one next to it. Zakaria, when he was standing in the mihrab, oh Allah, give me a son. Imagine this, and he was 99 years old. Allah called him while he's praying. The angels called him while he was praying. Ibadah. If you want to be steadfast, you see the curriculum, the manuscript was revealed to keep you busy. Ibn al-Qayyim, we're going to take 5 minutes, inshallah. Ibn al-Qayyim mentioned something very interesting. The nafs that you have in your body, if you don't occupy it with the truth, it will get you busy with falsehood. It's like having a child sitting next to you. Baba, daddy, daddy, baba, baba, you're trying to do something. Shut up. I mean, you can't do that, of course. Yeah, especially when you're in camera. Social service is going to take it away from you. Look at this now. Give the child a piece of paper and a pen. Okay, I want you to color that elephant. Color that elephant for me, please. He's going to at least take 10, 15 minutes. What? Especially if you color it with good colors, I'm going to give you a lollipop. I'm going to take you to Dunkin' Donuts, Halal McDonald's, huh? He's going to be, likewise, Allah. You see that salah that you're supposed to pray right now is supposed to help you be busy from the thinking about haram, thinking about weed, marijuana, girls, boys. That's all. Like Maryam was busy with the ibadah, steadfastness. طيب. Number 3, brotherhood. Wallahi zakiya ikhwa. Brotherhood, community. Shuf, when Allah said to us not to die but as Muslims, Ya ayyuha alladheena amanu ittaqullaha haqqa tuqati wa la tamutunna illa wa antum muslimun. Huh. We believe, don't you dare die but as Muslims. Allah immediately told you the first element which can help you die as a Muslim. Wa'tasimu. Be together. Be a community. Be together. Be together. Look at our masajid now. Fitin. Right and left. Fitin. People use the masjid for business. People, the masjid, you know, people come, oh, Pakistani people are better than Arab people. People have personal agendas in the masajid. Becoming what? There is no brotherhood in the masajid. People go to the masjid to gossip, to backbite, to harm one another. La. Brotherhood. You see, you're supposed to come here and see your brother. Oh, man, I miss you, Sami. You know the tent in Mina? You remember the tent in Mina? That the tent in Mina, you know. I always like, you guys need to go to Hajj so you have that feeling. Tent in Mina, you know, the Mina tent. People you don't know. You just become the, your brother. Why? Because when it's time to Salah, Allahu Akbar, Allah, Iqar, Salah. And then the Shaykh gave a dars. You're not busy with what? And the moment, if the Imam is smart, the moment that he sees the people starting talking about politics and stuff, he stands up and gives, hereafter, hellfire, back. Community, community. So this is 103, number 3, community or brotherhood, whatever you want to call it. 103 and 105. So this is number 3. You see in the Quran, when we read al-Fatiha, what do we say? Iyaka a'bud. What is the difference between a and na? Na. All of us together. A, you get one hasana. Na, you get how many hasanas? Jama'ah is more what? 26 times more. The salah in jama'ah is more than the salah by yourself, 26, and another hadith, 27 times. Incentive here, right? To be what? To be together. Number 4, verse 104 and 110. And I'm gonna really give you this from a revolutionary perspective. You know, if you study revolutions, and I'm talking about man-made revolutions, the people who wanna throw the existing power and they wanna take over. And they establish an ideology. They tell you, Ishaq, one of the ways to protect your own revolution, you have to export it. Your ideology have to be exported. You can't just keep it local. I mean, with all due respect, America does that. They go to Afghanistan, want to spread what? Democracy. That's the ideology. Hey, respect that. There is nothing wrong with that. They want to spread what? They want to protect what? Their lifestyle. Likewise in Islam. If you want to protect Islam, your Islam, call to it. Call to Islam. Don't shy away. Call to Islam. وَلْتَكُنْ مِنْكُمْ أُمَّةٌ يَدْعُونَ إِلَى الْخَيْرِ يَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَوْنَ. Call to Islam. Hey, I'm a Muslim. By the way, if you don't become Muslim, there is hell out there, man. Come on, what do you think about that? Come on, don't shy away. Don't shy away from calling people to Islam. Why? Why? Call people. Christians, they send people to Africa. They spend a lot of money in missionary work. And here you are in America, have people around you. Call them nicely, so be nice, be kind. You don't have to tell them about the hellfire right away, right? But call them to Islam. Call people to Islam. So one of the ways to be steadfast, you see, when you call others to your way, it will make you up strong. Wallahi, sometimes some people smoke cigarettes, not weed, cigarettes. So they come to me and say, you know, how can I stop smoking? I say, when you see a smoker, tell him not to smoke. Of course, that would be... You see, subhanallah, Allah will give you a share. And I love da'wah, Allah, not because, you know, I love da'wah because I get a share. I feel like if I do it, Allah will give me some guidance. You know, Allah will keep me steadfast. Calling people to Islam. Okay, is a subject that no one talks about, and we shouldn't talk about it. I'm saying it in the camera here. We shouldn't talk about it. Number 5, al-wala wal-bara. What is al-wala wal-bara? 28. Look at verse 28, and you guys explain it. 28. You guys tell me what does it say. I'm not going to say it. You guys tell me what does it say. What 28 says. Can you speak up, Nasser? So we get your voice here on the camera. Nasser? Nasser Jawara? Jawala? Let not the believers take the disbelievers for buddies and friends. No, friends here in the sense of what? You love them for being what? For being a worshiper of Jesus. But we're not talking about friends here that you talk to them, that you, you know, have a relationship. We're not talking about that. A lot of people misunderstand that concept. No. That you like them for being mushrik. And you compliment, oh, Christian is okay. It's okay. La, Christian is not okay in Islam. Islam, no. Islam tells you the way to salvation is La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. So what verse number is that? 28. So these are the five elements of steadfastness in Surah Al-Imran. Imagine this. You guys should understand Al-Imran now. Imagine this. Al-Imran in one lecture. And you can explain it. Can you? Jazakumullah khair. Inshallah, next week we're going to do what surah? The women. An-Nisa. That's your surah. So you invite a lot of sisters. Jazakumullah khair. Subhanak Allahum bihamdik. Ashadu an la ilaha illa ant. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. One of the requirements of this is you have a notebook. Of course, if you didn't bring it, this is going to be recorded maybe, or maybe you can borrow a piece of paper from somebody and a pen. And you need your English, whatever Quran, so you can navigate, because we're going to navigate through the verses. So I'm going to ask you, for example, to look at verse number 100. And then I'm going to ask you again to look at verse number 5. So you need to be able to navigate. You can use your phone if you have Quran on it, just to be able to navigate, because that's one of the requirements for this particular class. So you need a notebook, a pen, and you need a Quran to be able to navigate. But the Quran you understand, not in Arabic. Something that you're going to read and understand, inshallah.